to the Healthcare IT Today CIO podcast. I'm John Lin, the founder and chief editor at Healthcare IT Today, and I'm excited to bring you the most practical healthcare CIO insights and perspectives. We know your job is challenging, and we want to help you be more successful. And today's guest on our show is Juan Luis Cruz. He's CIO at Hospital Universitario 12 de Octubre, and I'm sorry for my terrible Spanish, but welcome and bienvenidos, Juan Luis.
Thank you, John. Great to be here with you. Encantado de estar contigo. Tu español es bastante bueno, no te preocupes.
Oh, gracias.
Don't worry about your Spanish.
I wish it was Italian, then we'd have some fun. But no, it's great to have your international perspective on our podcast. So before we dive into some of that, can you tell us a little bit about yourself and your organization?
Well, I'm a telecommunication and bioengineer by training. But I think I was attracted by the dark side of healthcare, you know, from the very beginning. I started working in an IT and a strategy consultancy firm. But as soon as they started working in healthcare, I said to the management, hey, I'm here. I have studied bioengineering. I want to work in healthcare. So first as a developer and after that as a systems strategist. And I think about 12 years ago or so, I took on my first hospital CIO role. And I'm still here, you know. And now in a bigger hospital since February last year, I'm in my current position in Hospital 12 de Octubre. Well, I don't know if you know a little bit about the Spanish National Health Service. I work in a public hospital.
Okay.
So we belong to the National Health Service in Spain. Spain has about 47 million inhabitants. And in Spain, we consider healthcare as a right in our constitution. Hmm. We have public funding and universal coverage and free healthcare service at the time of use. In the National Health Service here has been around 6% of our GDP. I think in total is the public and private spending is around 9% of our GDP. And the service provision here in Spain is decentralized. So we have 17 regions in Spain that manage the healthcare budget. So inside Spain, I work in the Madrid region health system that is around 7 million people. We have 35 hospitals and around 430 or so primary care centers.
Wow.
And here in Spain, we have probably 6 out of 10 of the best hospitals in Spain are concentrated here in Madrid region. And one of these top hospitals, it's probably one of top 3 in Madrid region and probably one of top 5 in Spain is Hospital 12 de Octubre. In fact, it's the only of its size that is a stage 6 hospital according to NRAM, to HIMSS standards.
Uh-huh.
We have around 7,000 professionals, more than 1,500 physicians and 3,000 nurses. And we cover around 500,000 people or so. So that's where I work.
It's impressive. It's impressive that you've adopted technology so well. And I want to dive into that since you brought it up around, you know, the fact that you have universal healthcare, you have government-run healthcare. Does that universal healthcare in Spain make your life as a CIO easier, or does it just bring up different challenges?
Well, probably as a CIO, it's easier, but especially as a citizen, you know.
Mm-hmm.
No one here in Spain goes bankrupt while trying to fight with cancer or another complex heart disease. In fact, I have read that around probably 500,000 families go bankrupt there in the U.S. due to medical debt per year. So in our view, and in my humble view, I think that's unacceptable. Here in Spain, we have, as I said, the public health system. Everyone has the right to be attended in the public health system. Everyone has the right to receive the best healthcare possible. And I think it is not only the fair thing to do, but also I think it's better, it's more cost effective. Here in Spain and in other European countries, we spend less than the US, but we have a better life expectancy. So maybe there are multiple evidences that a better access to healthcare allows better public health and so less healthcare cost. Here in Spain, we have a strong primary care system. We think that is more cost effective to have this kind of a strong primary care system than treating disease when it's maybe too late. Also, you can have top-notch hospitals and full of technology. It's always better to catch the disease before. So, well, I think as a CIO, that makes our life a little bit easier. We have another things that goes with this universal coverage, such a unique patient ID, you know, also that that makes our life much more easier, and a less bureaucracy, probably, regarding payments and models. I think that they are quite complex there in the US, and here in Spain, in the public sector is much more straightforward.
Yeah, it feels like it when you're working on an IT project, you can focus more on the patient since you're less worried about reimbursements since it's standardized. Yes, but how is it being a CIO in Spain different than what you hear maybe from your counterparts and colleagues in the US? What do you think, what are some of the differences that you hear them talk about that you're like, oh, I don't deal with that? Or maybe I deal with it and my US counterparts don't have to deal with.
I think it's not quite different in the essential. Maybe. Really? I've been lucky to attend several CHIME events here and in the US. So I have seen with my own eyes how similar are our challenges as CIOs. So they are not so different, but indeed there are some difference. I think some important difference. For example, on one side, on the positive one, I'd say. Probably my peers in the US have more resources. Here in Spain, we spend less than 1% of our budget in IT.
Wow.
And probably comparable US health systems, top health systems, are probably around 3-6% or something like that. Also regarding the staff, it's probably as high as 10 times more the IT staff in a comparable hospital than in our hospital. For example, I have around 20 full-time equivalents working in our IT department, and we are a 1,200 beds hospital. If you apply the common standards, the ratios, probably we should have 200 people working in IT, not 20. Maybe also they benefit from an easier access to state of the art tech. You know, the main companies, the main IT companies, are from the US, and somehow they can access easily top company executive. You know, I was quite surprised when I attended CHIME events that I could talk with the CEO of the top companies in IT, in health IT, in the world, and they were there in the event. You know?
Come for a visit to Spain. They don't want a little trip to Spain to.
Yes, we should work on that to convince them to visit us. But it's is much more difficult. And of course, salaries also is a big difference. Probably three times higher is what a US CIO earn compared to a CIO here in Spain. But on the other side, that's the positive side, I think. But on the other side, as I said previously, I think you have a more complex, much more complex legislation. I think a lot of bureaucracy, probably related to all those complex payment models.
Yeah, for sure.
And also the lack of patient ID. It's something that for us, I know it's somehow a cultural thing, but for us it's quite difficult to understand why don't you have a patient ID?
Well, Juan Luis, as an American citizen, it's something hard for us to understand too. We don't try to explain the politics, but yeah, that's a good point.
Yes, I know that it has some reasons, that cultural reasons maybe, but at that time, it makes life so much easier to have this unique identifier and at least using that as a lever to interoperate with other institutions and sharing data, you know.
Yeah, for sure. And as you saw with Chime, they were at one point doing $1 million prize to try to solve the problem because it is such an important problem. So I think most of us here that work in healthcare want to change that, but welcome to the US politics. So looking at this, your job as a CIO, what are some of the big challenges that you're facing right now and you're trying to deal with?
Well, not sure what to say about that. I think our work is all about challenges. We are continuously facing challenges. We are problem solvers somehow. So maybe there are some common challenges worldwide. Probably the rapid evolution of technology, you know, cybersecurity, clinician burnout, and what's the role of IT in clinician burnout, extracting value of our data. Some common challenges, I think, we all have. Specifically for me now, as I have taken on my new role not so long ago, I think that things like internal organization and optimization, attracting talent to the IT department, or just keeping the lights on, are now, for me, great challenges in my hospital. But I'd say that also our hospital is doing now a great transformation process, because we are redesigning our strategy bottom-up. It's people, clinicians, are having meetings and defining what's the strategy for the next 4 years. And we are preparing for a whole new building that is going to be one of the most advanced hospitals in the world, I hope. So we are in a great transformation process, and that's a very big challenge also for me now.
Yeah. It's amazing to hear you go through some of those challenges and how universal they are. Some of the physician burnout, for example, it's amazing how that's such a universal challenge. And
also, we benefit of that easier payment model that avoid clinicians to write down a lot of administrative information. They are more focus on clinical data, not so administrative data, but also it's a big problem here in Spain when the doctors and nurses who use our EMRs, they always complain about the way it prevents them from talking with the patient face to face, and they are wasting time in administrative tasks. You know, it's something universal, I think.
I think the most universal thing is doctors. and how they interact with IT. That's such a universal principle. But to your point, I mean, I forget the exact stat, but Judy Faulkner from Epic, I think she said that the international notes on Epic were, I want to say it was a third, or maybe it was two thirds. I forget exactly the stat, but just significantly smaller than those in the US because of the, you know, they were documenting the clinical outcomes rather than the other. So that's a huge, you know, here in the US, we have to document these bloated notes, or, and there's some question of have to, but we have these bloated notes in order to get paid. And so, you know, it must be nice that you don't have to deal with that.
Yes. That's great. Yes, definitely.
So as you look at your career, it's nice. You've been, you know, CIO at a number of hospitals for a good period of time. What's the best piece of advice that you've been given that might help another CIO who's dealing with their own challenges?
I think I've been very lucky to meet great CIOs and leaders in my career so far. And many of them through Chime. I'm very grateful to Chime for the opportunity that gave us coming to Spain. I think 5 years ago or so, they started to visit us in Spain and sharing their vision and their knowledge. And after that, I received some scholarship also to visit Chime. I remember San Antonio, Texas, and San Diego. It's difficult because I have met a lot of interesting people in these events and along my career. But just to mention three that come to my mind, my former CEO said to me once, say always yes and think later. You say yes and then think. But at first, you never say. You should never say no. You say yes. I have used it a lot in my career. Another one also is dare to do great things. It's quite similar to this motto from the Jet Propulsion Laboratory that sent the spaceship Perseverance to Mars. Uh-huh. I think they say something similar. Dare to mighty things or something like that. It's something that I use sometimes in as a motto, as a Latin motto. You know, uh-huh. You know the Romans said "audentes fortuna iubat," said okay. The Romans, and that's fortune favors the bold.
Yeah, I love that one.
And I think it's quite true. You have to dare to do things, and. Sometimes it goes wrong, but sometimes you can succeed. But if you don't dare, you can succeed. And probably the last one, well, it's not exactly a CIO, but it's that the do or do not, there is no try. From Jordan, he's not a CIO, but maybe he could be a great CIO also. And yeah. I have applied also many things in my career probably.
Nah, that's great. And I would expect nothing less than a little romantic Roman advice from a European. So that's awesome. That's great. So what other innovations and technologies are you kind of keeping an eye on as something which will really help your organization? Is there something that you're kind of watching and saying, yeah, I need this in my organization?
This is also difficult for us because we try to keep an eye almost in every new technology around. Uh-huh. But in general, we have a poor access to market research studies, at least here in Spain. Probably, as I said, our budgets are quite low and we can afford to some of the best knowledge that is in market research. So we have to rely a lot in local IT providers or trying to get feedback from other CIO peers. That's why organizations such as HIMSS or Chime could have help us a lot, just sharing experiences with technologies, with new technologies. Yeah. But if I had to choose one, probably I'd say everything related to data. Tools related to acquisition, transformation, standards, data analysis, machine learning, and AI. I think it's the future for us to extract value from data. It's, of course, that there are a lot of technologies around, cloud, 5G. But everything related to data is where we should focus, I think.
And do you think you'll work with a vendor to have them do the data analysis? Or do you picture it that you want to buy some tools to allow your in-house people to do the data analysis? How do you think about that as a CIO?
In my experience, you need to work quite close with the clinicians to extract knowledge and value from data. It's not something that you can send to an external provider and then do some kind of analysis and get back the knowledge. It's difficult. You have to work quite closely in an iterative way, presenting them data, and then analyzing them and asking for new things. And then you have to prepare again data and work again. So I think it's more about having a platform in the hospital. A platform that is, in fact, is one of our top projects now. It's called Infobanco or Infobank. That is trying to establish a platform that can get information from operational systems and extract information, process information for different outputs, real world data repositories, traditional data analytics platforms, research databases, AI. So once we have this kind of platform, we can try to give the data to the researchers and work with them quite closely.
Nice. Sounds like a good effort. And, I agree completely that the future is built on the back of data and understanding that data and leveraging that data to make us more efficient.
Yes, I think so, definitely.
So, just to kind of wrap things up here, I've appreciated all your insights. I've loved hearing this unique international perspective. But, how, as you look at your job, how is your job as CIO going to change in the next, say, 5 to 10 years? And what do you think CIOs need to do to be ready? I mean, it's an evolving ecosystem. The technology's changing. There's a lot going on. So what would be your advice to people and how the role of CIO is going to change?
Well, I think that healthcare CIOs, probably like in other sectors, have to be more engaged with business. Mm-hmm. We have an advantage that is, we know, or at least we could know if we want, many things about the actual healthcare process. So maybe we should free more of our time to get more in touch with the chief medical officer, the chief nurse officer, with the clinicians, with the nurses leaders. Usually we spend a lot of efforts trying to just to keep the lights on, and of course that's necessary. But in my view, innovation and true value comes working hand to hand with the clinical staff. It's where you can extract what you can realize the full potential of health IT. And probably also we should do more work. We should have a work more as a network with other CIO peers. I think complexity, as you said, is increasing every year. Our ecosystem is more complex, and we should support each other and not working in an isolated way. Especially, for example, in our case, that we work in a public health system, so there is no competition.
Yeah.
In us, but we tend to work isolated, facing isolated, the same problems, just in the same region, in Madrid region or in Spain, everyone inside their castle, trying to solve the problem that is now providing IT service for a hospital or for a big hospital. So networking with others, I think is the way ahead also.
Love it. Thanks so much, Juan Luis. This was a lot of fun learning about kind of the international perspective on being a healthcare CIO. Really appreciate you taking time and gracias. really appreciate it. And thanks everyone for listening to the Healthcare IT Today CIO podcast. If you want to find more great health IT content like this, be sure to check it out at healthcareittoday.com. Thanks so much, Juan Luis.
Thank you, John. Gracias. Gracias a todos.